Sometimes in movies, the most slow, boring and drawn-out scenes turn out to have the most interesting stuff going on subliminally. A giveaway about this can often be found when a snail-paced send-you-half-to-sleep scene appears in a movie by a director who is normally efficient with regards to editing and pacing, an uncharacteristic sore thumb scene. And when you realise what the subliminal content is, you get that forehead-slapping, duh, how did I miss that feeling? And you never view the scene in the same way you originally did. One of my favourite examples of this is from Alfred Hitchcock's combined surrealist relationship drama murder mystery movie called Vertigo. Lead character Scotty has been hired to follow a friend's wife around town and find out where she's going and what she's up to. There are all sorts of plot twists in the movie, with layers upon layers of false identity and false motives being gradually stripped away. In this scene, which is probably the most boring scene in the entire movie on surface appearances, Scotty follows the woman in his car, and it takes up over 2 minutes of screen time. An efficient editor could have reduced that to just a few seconds by simply showing the start and end of the driving sequence with a visual dissolve to imply the passing of time. As a former movie editor himself, Hitchcock would have been fully aware of that option. And yet he suddenly appears to lose all sense of pacing, editing efficiency, and economy of statement in this scene. I'll just let the scene continue to roll for a little while, and I'll ask you to look out for the subliminal content and try not to fall into a trance. Alright, did you notice anything subliminal? Well, here's one aspect, and I think it is the entire point of the sequence. It's well known that Hitchcock used a lot of spiral symbolism in the movie. The opening titles prominently show a series of spiral designs, which is appropriate given the head-spinning multitude of plot twists that await. And in this driving sequence, no matter which corner Scotty's car turns, he's almost always driving downhill, like he's on a downward spiral. And the route taken by the girl he's following is a pretty senseless spaghetti pattern in itself. She takes two rights, then a left, then two more rights, which would basically mean looping back almost to where she started from. Then left, then right, then two lefts, then finally a right before she's home. The path she took him on looks something like this. No wonder Scotty looks confused. Now I'm going to take you through some map details here because I found this stuff quite funny. Unfortunately, it defeats my aim of keeping this video under 3 minutes long, but what the hell. Looking at a Google map of the area, the first two turns on the journey are accurate. You can see the Brocklebank Apartments. Then after she turns right twice, Huntington Park is on our left, and that's correct. Then we turn left, and the park is still on our left, which is correct. Then she takes two rights and ends up on Clay Street, which is correct again, but once we're onto that street, it's actually a different location with a clear view of the Oakland Bay Bridge. And that's not what the Google map shows. This is what Clay Street looks like when you turn that corner, minus the San Francisco Pyramid Building, which wasn't there when the film was made. So, location continuity has suddenly been completely broken, but then we turn left and we're back onto Mason Street and turning onto Washington Street, which are both correct in accordance with the starting location of the trip and the turns that she's made. Then turn left onto Powell Street, which is correct, except once we're on there, this steep view is nothing like the actual street. We should be seeing something like this. Then left again, after which we should be driving west, but instead we're actually driving north, and we've leapt about 6 blocks up the map and a couple of blocks across to Leavenworth Street. And we can just see a Lombard Street sign on the right here. On the Google map, Lombard Street turns out to be a famous spaghetti-shaped road. How appropriate. Scotty takes a right onto that road just after the windy section. Now, it would have been great if Scotty had been made to drive down the spaghetti road section, but maybe it would have defeated the subliminal effect of the scene by making it all too obvious. Instead, we get the windy section of road snuck into the shot behind Scotty in the rear screen projection, which shows just how carefully this whole sequence has been thought out. In fact, if you go back through the whole driving sequence, the rear screen projection continuity is excellent, except for the roads where it suddenly switched to some other location. By the way, there are two similar looking green cars here going in different directions before Scotty makes his final turn. And that might be part of the subliminal confusion effort too, which car is he supposed to be chasing? Cut to front view on the final street scene and continuity is maintained. This is actually Lombard Street, which has got the windy section further at the back. So what seems to be a boring scene at the conscious casual viewing level is actually a perception twisting means of disorientating the viewer. Pretty awesome detailed work from a pioneer subliminal director way back in 1958, nearly 60 years ago. And the whole movie is full of brain twist and subliminals too. For more film analysis, including my full study of the movie Vertigo, visit my site, collativelearning.com. The link to that is in the video description below. If you've not seen my work before, then make sure to subscribe and check out my many other videos on my YouTube channels. Oh, and if you've got any friends who are into subliminal stuff and psychology and things like that, show them this vid and see if they can spot the subliminals too. Bye for now.